Our scripture reading today comes from the book of Judges, chapter 16, verses 15 through 22. And I'll invite you to hear the word with open ears, an open mind, and an open heart. Delilah said to him, "How can you say, 'I love you,' when you won't trust me? Three times now you've made a fool out of me and not told me what gives you such great strength." She nagged him with her words day after day and begged him until he became worn out to the point of death. Side note. I've been in a relationship like that. And some of you are parents and know what this feels like too. So he told her his whole secret. He said to her, "No razor has ever touched my head because I've been a Nazarite for God from the time I was born. If my head is shaved, my strength will leave me and I'll become weak. I'll be like every other person." When Delilah realized that he had told her his whole secret, she went to send words to the rulers of the Philistines. "Come one more time, for he has told me his whole secret." The rulers of the Philistines came up to her and brought the silver with them. She got him to fall asleep with his head on her lap. Then she called a man and had him shave off the 7 braids of Samson's hair.
Shave his dreads.
He began to weaken and his strength left him. She called out, "Samson, the Philistines are on you." He woke up from his sleep and thought, "I'll escape just like the other times and shake myself free." But he didn't realize that the Lord had left him. So the Philistines captured him, put out his eyes, and took him down to Gaza. They bound him with bronze chains, and he worked the grinding mill in the prison. But the hair on his head began to grow again right after it had been shaved. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And some other words just thrown in for good measure.
That last sentence in there is my second favorite Bible verse. The hair on his head began to grow again right after it had been shaved. There is hope. Amen. Amen. So for some of you, anyway, that's what I thought. Right, now, we're closing out our Summer Heroes series with the Star Wars, with a Star Wars trilogy of sermons. And we're looking at a couple of things. One is the story of Samson, who was a tremendous hero who falls from grace, but has an interesting comeback that we'll get to next week. And then we're also kind of comparing and contrasting that story, laying it side by side with the story of Anakin Skywalker from the Star Wars trilogy. As we said last week, George Lucas grew up Methodist, and there's a lot of grace in the story of Anakin, and that's the story we're focusing on. Now, would you believe that last Sunday, when I woke up in the morning, Michelle Pounds had come to bed after I went to sleep. And when I woke up, I was lying underneath my very favorite Return of the Jedi blanket. Amen? So I'm a big Star Wars fan, but I had a couple of people come out last week, and they were like, "Who is this Anakin guy?" and stuff like that. And so let's just, it's only, 30 years old, 40 years old or whatever, but Anakin Skywalker becomes
Darth Vader.
Everybody know who Darth Vader is? Raise your hand. Everybody seen Darth Vader at some point? All right. Anakin becomes Darth Vader. And then he has this ultimate destiny that we're going to talk about next Sunday. So we'll be talking about Anakin and his son, Luke, and how Luke confronts his evil father next Sunday. Now, our devotionals and our Traveler's Companion this week deal with one story in the book of Genesis. It's the story of Joseph and how he confronted his evil brothers who threw him into the well and sold him into slavery, like any good older brothers would do. But anyway, that's not the way to tell that. But we encourage you to make the devotionals in your Traveler's Companion a part of your daily practices of prayer and Bible study. this week. You can take your travel companion out. There's some space there on the front where you can take notes if you find that helpful. But let's begin with a word of prayer. Would you pray with me and for me today? Amen? Amen. Let's pray. God, we do thank you for all of your blessings and for being with us in the midst of our pain and our sorrow and our heartache. God, we know because of the gift of your Son, Jesus, that we never go through any of that kind of stuff alone. And we are grateful. And so now we pray that you will give us your Spirit. May everything that I say and everything that we ponder in our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, you who are our strength and our friend, our rock and our redeemer. The people of God said, amen. Just before I begin, I want to let you know, I feel a lot better than I sound, amen? And my voice problem is just a source of strong frustration, and that's about it, all right? So I'm doing okay, I'm feeling okay, but anyway, just please tolerate my... This is the voice I actually had when the Return of the Jedi came out, when I was 12. Well, let's begin. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. Two paths. One clear, one grassy, one well-worn, one untouched, one easy, one treacherous. Two paths, one light, the other dark. As we saw last week, Samson was God's chosen one, the one that whom God chose to deliver and lead his people from bondage into freedom. But Samson, the great hero, the great and mighty warrior, fell. Four things that he wasn't supposed to do. Do you remember? Wasn't supposed to drink alcohol. Wasn't supposed to touch a dead body. Wasn't supposed to eat anything unclean. And then finally, I know you know this one, he wasn't supposed to cut his hair. And God, Samson obeyed all these things, and God made him very, very strong. One of the strong, like on the level of Hercules strong. He was a great warrior. The story goes that once Samson went out and he caught 300 foxes. 300 foxes, and he lit their tails on fire and then set them loose in his enemy's fields. So they ran through the fields and lit up all of the wheat and burned the crops to the ground. Another day, his enemies caught him and tied him up. And there, with his big Superman muscles, he broke free of the ropes using nothing but his arms. And then he grabbed up a donkey's jawbone and killed 1,000 of his enemies. Amen? I'm always reminded of a sermon I heard one time, and the preacher said, if God can do that with the jawbone of an ass, imagine what he can do with you. Amen? He was a great hero, a mighty warrior. But one day, Samson was walking along and he saw a lion. And he grabbed it and he ripped it apart with his bare hand. And as I said at 8:30, I hope he had a license to do that. But it wasn't in a wildlife refuge or something like that. Anyway, I think that's anachronistic. But anyway, he rips this lion in half. The next day, he walks by the carcass of this lion. And he sees that some bees have set up shop in the body of this lion. And they've created a honeycomb. And there's honey in this dead lion. And so, what does he do? He's kind of a dumb jock. Not that all jocks are dumb jocks. But he goes over. And he reaches into... This is nasty, y'all. I'm just going to tell you right from all right? So, if you can't tolerate, you might be okay to eat lunch. But I hope you ate breakfast way early this morning. But, he reaches into the carcass of this dead lion and he scoops out the honey and he eats it. Yeah, he did. That's exactly right. Now, I tell you that, well, first of all, because it's in the Bible, you can double check that if you want. But he touched a dead body and ate something unclean at the same time. Amen? Those are two of those rules that he was supposed to follow. And then, you know the story we heard, we read this part just a moment ago. Delilah did what? She cut his
hair.
He let his hair be cut. And we're never told to that he drank alcohol, but we do know that Samson had sex with a prostitute. And that was so obviously wrong that there wasn't even a rule for it, amen? So, Samson chose the easy path. And it led to destruction in his life. He gave into temptation, and it left him weak, with his eyes put up, and tied up in chains. Anakin Skywalker was also a chosen one, And as a slave child, he was very, very gifted. He had a knack for fixing things. For doing what? For fixing things. And he was also a tremendously good pilot, even as a little boy. And young Anakin dreamed of becoming a good guy, becoming a Jedi Knight. Well, his dream came true. And we saw last week that Obi-Wan Kenobi and another knight came and rescued Anakin from slavery. Obi-Wan eventually became Anakin's mentor and his best friend, and started trying to teach him how to use the power that he had for good. Together, Obi-Wan and Anakin fought many battles, and like Samson, Anakin showed amazing skill. Well, 10 years of this training went by. About 10 years of this training passed, and Anakin's dream suddenly turned into nightmares. He started having visions in which his mother, his dear beloved mother, who had to remain in slavery because they couldn't afford to buy her out, he had dreams that his mother was suffering terribly due to torture, and in which she, in his dreams, she would die. Eventually, these dreams became way too much for Anakin to bear, so he broke the rules. He did something he wasn't supposed to do. He snuck off. None of y'all ever sneak out, did you? I never did either. Anyway, I did once, and you know, you can't sneak out in Dumas, Arkansas. Next Tuesday, my buddy Otis says to my parents while they're getting their groceries, "Hey, parents, we're going to see Hammett at that party the other night." I got in so much trouble. She was the Baptist choir director's daughter, too. But anyway, that's another story. Anyway, there was nothing going on at that party. But Jesus used it. And it was just fun. And he goes back to his home planet. And tracks down his mother. Can't find her. Sure enough, she has been captured by these enemies. And he tracks her down. He finds her. She has been tortured. She has been suffering greatly. And his beloved mother dies in Anakin's arms. It's too much for him to bear. Anakin is just absolutely filled with rage, and he can't control himself, and so he wreaks vengeance upon those who murdered his mother. Later on, he pours his heart out to his girlfriend and future wife, Hammett. Hammett says, "Sometimes there are things no one can fix. Sometimes there are things no one can fix." And it's true, isn't it? Someone you love is terminally ill. A baby is stillborn. One group of people massacres another. Twin girls die as being born. Your stepmom is sick for years with a disease that she didn't deserve and didn't do anything to get. And then she dies in a place where she never wanted. Sometimes there are things that no one can fix. If you live long enough, one thing is for sure. There is going to be pain in your life. You're going to experience loss. You're going to grieve. Sometimes there are things no one can fix. So the question for each and every one of us is, how will we respond to that pain? What will we do when pain enters our lives? Well, Anakin, if you've seen the films, chooses the easy path. And it's not an immediate thing, it doesn't happen all at once, but slowly, over about a 3-year time period, Anakin keeps choosing the easy path. And he falls into evil. He responds to his pain by inflicting pain on others. And in the end, he almost kills his wife. And almost kills his best friend. He chose the path of destruction. He became a mass murderer. An agent of evil. And it nearly cost him his own life. Incarcerated then in a black suit of life-preserving armor, Anakin Skywalker became the evil Darth Vader. Many years later, Anakin's son Luke faced the very same temptations to fear and hatred and rage as his father. Now, at this point in the story, Luke did not yet know that Darth Vader was his dad. That truth had been kept from him. He had only been told that Vader betrayed and murdered his father, which was true from a particular point of view. Luke wanted vengeance. He wanted vengeance for the murder against the murderer of his father. And so he went and sought advice and training from a wise old Jedi master, whose name was... I was 9 years old when the Empire Strikes Back came out. I won't make anybody feel old, or I don't want anybody to think I'm that old either. I'm almost 10 years old, and I didn't understand the meaning of that vision that Luke has in the cave. But when I saw it when I got a little bit older, I realized that it has a very clear and simple meaning. When we choose to take out our fear and anger and hatred and rage on any other human being, the only person we destroy is ourself.
Amen.
There has to be a better way. The book of Hebrews points us in the right direction when it says that Jesus was tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. Jesus was tempted in every way as we are, yet without sin. You see, Jesus knew pain better than most of us in this room. But instead of turning around and inflicting pain on others, Jesus simply loved. He forgave. He had compassion even upon those who tortured and executed him. Jesus showed us that it is possible to turn our pain into compassion for others who are hurting. My dad used to tell a fable when I was growing up. I'm one of those rare Methodists that had the same preacher for 18 years. And that was my dad. And he was, you know, I'm a preacher's kid, and he was my pastor for the whole time I was growing up. Anyway, he used to tell this fable about a lion and a mouse. And you may have heard some stories like this one before, but this is my dad's version of it. Dad said, once upon a time, there was a lion who was asleep. And this foolish mouse came and did what foolish mice do. It started running all over the lion. And sure enough, it woke the lion up from sleep. The lion jumped up and grabbed the mouse and was about to eat him alive, when the mouse started screaming and begging, please, please, don't do it. Please forgive me. I'll never forget it if you do. Maybe someday I can repay the favor and help you. Well, that made the lion laugh, because how in the world could a little tiny mouse ever help a big old lion, the king of the jungle, as he was? And so he started laughing, but sure enough, many years later, the lion was walking down a path in the forest and stepped upon a thorn. And the thorn pressed very deep into the flesh of the lion's paw. And he fell down, writhing and screaming in agony. Well, as it happened, that very same mouse who had helped the lion, or who had been saved by the lion many years before, also came down the path. And when he came to the lion recognized him and said, hey, brother, please help me. Can you please pull this thorn out of my paw? The mouse looked Oh, I'm so sorry, but I can't. I can't do that. And then he stretched out his own paw to the lion. And there in his tiny mouse paw was a thorn. And the mouse said, "Friend, I can't take your pain, but I can share it, and I can teach you how to bear it with dignity and grace and love." The meal that we're about to share reminds us that God does not always take our pain away. Often, God shares our pain. And God teaches us how to bear our pain with grace and love and kindness. That is the trail that is less traveled, and yet the one that has been blazed by Jesus Christ Himself for us. Would you join me in prayer as Pete prepares God's table for us?